Arun Kumar Maurya, a very eminent person in the field of botany, in the field of environment, in the field of law, and he's a wildlife photographer, a very accomplished wildlife photographer. And also, you may be knowing that he has authored many books, and his books are being taught in various universities. Friends, we are dealing with an important topic, and as you know, that this topic is being, widely debated world over. And the climate actions are being seen as one of the most prominent actions given by the people. Therefore, we have decided to deal with the environmental laws, states' obligation, and impact of climate change. So thank you for joining us. Now I request my friend Rishira Singh to give a little introduction of her to be a friend of Arun Kumar Maurya. Thank you.
Hi, I am supposed to introduce.
Oh, I'm so sorry.
Maurya.
I request my friend Sumit Chauhan to give a detailed introduction of my friend Dr. Arun Kumar Maurya. Actually, what happened, I'm joining Ambedkar School after a long day, so I forgot everything.
Jai Bheem to all. Aap sabko Jai Bheem. It's my pleasure to introduce Dr. Arun Kumar Maurya. Dr. Maurya is an assistant professor in Department of Botany at MMPG College, Modi Nagar, Ghaziabad. He did his BSc in Botany, Chemistry and Zoology in 1999 from University of Lucknow, MSc in Botany from Ramjas College, University of Delhi. He's also proceeded his MPhil in Botany from University of Delhi, and he's also a PhD holder in Botany. Title of his PhD was thesis, Studies on the Certain Aspect of Growth and Metabolism of Vigna Unguiculata, Bulb in response to nitrogen fertilizer. Dr. Maurya was selected at first rank for the post of Assistant Professor Botany through UP Higher Education Service Commission in 2017. He received Senior Research Fellowship from CSIR in 2008 and 2009. His work is published in world's most prominent journals. Dr. Maurya developed study material of biology for class 11th and 12th for CBSE in 2012. Dr. Maurya wrote 5 chapters for the book titled Basic Environmental Studies in 2015. He's also edited the book. Dr. Maurya is also highly qualified in law. He was the entrance exam topper of DU's LLB entrance exam. He's a gold medalist in LLB and LLM. He's the author of Basic Intellectual Property Rights Law Concept and Cases book. Dr. Maurya is also a worldwide recognized wildlife photographer. His photos are highly appreciated all over the globe. And I'm also a big fan of your photography, sir. Anyway, list of his academic qualification and achievements is so long. So I just, conclude here. Dr. Maurya will teach us on environmental law, state's obligation, and impact of climate change. So thank you all. Over to you, Dr. Maurya.
Thank you, sir, for such a nice introduction. Today I have been given assignment to talk on 3 aspects. One is the impact of climate change, state obligation, and environmental laws. These are very heavyweight sections. I have tried to make them, in a nutshell, and I'll try to give equal weightage to deal these 3 aspects so that I can justify the topic. I'm beginning with my presentation slides.
So there is a share screen option at the bottom.
Yeah, I'm. No. Is it visible?
Not yet, sir. So just click on share screen. It will take you to desktop. It will take you to desktop. Click on desktop share.
Yeah. Now it has come.
Select the file. Yeah, now it's visible, sir.
I think now it is visible.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So thank you once again for the opportunity to talk on the channel Shudra. The topic is environmental laws, state obligation, and impact of climate change. Now, in this, we can see these three areas: impact of climate change, environmental laws, and state obligation. These are integrated, interrelated aspects. We cannot talk separate. We have to link them together to find out a solution, to find out any kind of, you know, a remedy which is going to harm us in future. But before entering into the topic, I would like to just have a glimpse what are the conceptual aspect of climate change. So as we know that the climate change is known as change in average atmospheric conditions. These atmospheric conditions involves temperature, humidity, rainfall, pressure, moisture, whatever components which are part of atmospheric condition. If there is a change from, you know, past in these aspects, we can say climate change. Now, there is another concept related with climate change known as global warming. Global warming is ongoing phenomena. These climate change and global warming are interlinked aspect. We can see the Earth faces these two phenomena repeatedly over the time. Sometime it goes cooler, sometime it goes warmer. So when there is a phase which is warm, we say global warming. When there is a phase of low temperature, we say cooling of Earth atmosphere. When these ongoing process results into a long-term effect, we call it climate change. So climate change is an outcome of global warming or global cooling, because there is nothing which remains static forever. Things change. And what are the factors that we will discuss later? So this climate change occurs naturally. It occurs man-made also. Now, naturally, in the course of history of Earth, we know that four time, you know, cooling phases and warming phases have come. Now we are in the next phase. This cooling and warming has their own impact on the Earth as well as on living being. Currently, we are facing climate change, which is man-made. And it can be seen as when industrial revolution started, because at that time we started using coal in excess amount. And that point of time can be called as we started the global warming. So present climate change is basically nothing but enhanced global warming due to man-made activities. Conceptually, to understand the climate change, we need to always remember two things. and this we will use in future course of our discussion. When there is change in concentration of atmospheric gases, and when there is change in composition of atmospheric gases. So these are the two things which leads to global warming and ultimately to the climate change. Now, as an example, we can see these examples, these data have been collected from report prepared by a well-known institution called as IPCC, International Panel on Climate Change, which has received Nobel Prize also. They have given data that in the last 100 year, the temperature has gone 3 centigrade to 6 centigrade. And due to this increase, there is increase, you know, melting, and consequently global sea level has increased 10 to 20 centimeter high. So the visible effects are, you know, clearly seen now. By their report, we can see that the temperature, average temperature of atmosphere has gone from 13.5 to 14.5. And this data is from 1961 to 1919. Now we are 20 years ahead. So definitely there is more increase in the temperature. So average temperature has gone up. Consequently, the global average sea level has also gone up, and the sea level has been, you know, result of melting of snow cover. So you can see there is decline in snow cover. So the data is clearly indicating that the era which we are living is global warming, and consequently climate change is visible. So I'll not take much more time on conceptual area, but how these climate change occur, how these global warming occur, we can understand by understanding two things. One is the heat buzzard of Earth, and other is the greenhouse effect. As we know that for Earth, we have only one source of energy, major source of energy, that is sun. So we receive solar radiation in the form of incoming solar radiation, which is called as insolation. And we assume that we are receiving 100%, whatever amount is coming, because this amount is, you know, variable, subject to different time and space. But there is a input of energy. That energy is, you know, absorbed by four components of our Earth. One is the lithosphere, second is the hydrosphere, third is the biosphere, and fourth is the atmosphere. So these all components absorb energy and they release energy. So energy comes in the form of short wavelength, high energy radiation, and it goes out in the form of long wave radiation. In the course of coming and going, the energy is absorbed and transformed as a heat. So some amount of heat is absorbed by land, some amount of heat absorbed by water, some amount of heat absorbed by biological organisms, and large chunk absorbed by the atmosphere. So you can see here different percentages which are given there. This absorbance and release is not a quick process. The energy comes, it is withheld, and then gradually released as a heat, long wave radiation. In the course of this lag period, the atmosphere retains certain amount of energy, and that makes the Earth warmer, Earth atmosphere warmer. So we can see how much amount of water as a vapor, as carbon dioxide, other gases are present in atmosphere, they retain the energy. If you have a more carbon dioxide, you will retain more energy. If you have a less carbon dioxide, you will retain less energy. Similarly for water, similarly for other gases. So in totality, we can see the composition and concentration of gases present in atmosphere decides how much energy you hold in your atmosphere that makes the earth warmer. So this decides your budget. If you disturb your budget, the consequently results will be, you know, affected. The second one is, as we have said, the greenhouse effect. So greenhouse effect we can understand by taking a very simple example of a car. We usually, you know, face whenever you go out, you park your car in the parking, and after some time you come back, you find your car is very warm or hot inside, and outside temperature is very less in comparison to inside. Why it happens? Because the window allows the short wave radiation to enter inside the car, and the consequent loss of energy, and there's a formation of long wave which cannot go outside completely. So some amount of energy is retained as heat, and that keeps inside much more warmer than the outside. So similar phenomena we can see in Earth. Here we have an atmosphere. The sunlight is coming. It is entering into atmosphere and going out. In the meantime, these gases retains the energy and make the Earth warmer. So this greenhouse effect in nature is good for sustaining life on Earth, because there is a need to keep temperature for various kind of organisms. In the past, the human population and other population were less, but gradually the population has increased of all species. Later on, some population has declined also, but now the human population has gone up. They have started using resource, and they have consumed fossil fuel, coal, and very many, many other things, and they have burned it, and consequently gases have released, and they have caused the, you know, change in composition of atmosphere. And that's why the energy retaining capacity of atmosphere has gone up. And that is why the warming is seen. So this greenhouse effect occurs just because of the presence of gases. Now, all gases are not, having potential for making the effect. Some are very important, which has been recognized by the, you know, scientists and various academics. So there are certain gases which are called as greenhouse gases. These are carbon dioxide, methane, CFC, nitric oxide, and one gas which is not mentioned here is SF6, sulfur hexafluoride. These six gases have been considered as potential greenhouse gases, GHG. Now you can see in a quick look, atmospheric concentration, pre-industrial atmospheric concentration, present day atmospheric concentration, and current rate of change per year, and their lifetime. This slide itself says that the concentration and composition of all these six potential gases have increased. So due to increase in their concentration, increase in the composition. And now how this composition has gone changed? Because here you can see CFC. This gas is not nature made. It is made by the human being. So human have introduced certain gases which are not naturally made. That is why the composition has gone changed. So due to this change in concentration of gases and their composition, it has changed the heat budget. It has affected the heat budget, and it has led to retaining more energy in atmosphere, and consequently the global warming or climate change is visible. This is the same slide which shows how much percentage of gases are released from different sector like industry, transportation, agriculture, electricity, and what are the gases: nitric oxide, methane, carbon dioxide. So it simply represents these are the gases and these are the sources which are emitting these greenhouse gases. Those are affecting the climate change. Now, only for the just nutshell, causes of climate change. So there are many causes, but for the sake of making it clear, I have just listed 8 causes. One is regional and global variation in case of temperature, pressure. That is also one of the factors that helps in developing climate change. The link with general circulation. General circulation means our Earth has hydrosphere. The hydrosphere is divided into many oceans. Some are, you know, Atlantic, Pacific, Hind Mahasagar, all these. So what happens if some part is warmer, some part is cooler, the water moves from warmer to cooler area. So it carries the amount of heat. So it distributes the heat. So general circulation of this water, and consequently, when water is moving, the upper atmosphere also gets affected, because where the warmer water is present, there is a low pressure, and there is a cool, there is a, you know, high pressure. So atmosphere also changes with the movement of this water. So it also affects the condition. Then the point is solar cycle. Solar cycle is simply, it has been said that sun releases burst of heat after certain time period. And it has been found that 11 to 12 year, after 11 to 12 year, there is a burst. And that burst is basically increase in energy, and that comes to Earth. And consequently, there is increase in temperature. Then there is a change in atmospheric condition. It is a natural way also, in man-made also. When we are introducing the gases, atmospheric conditions are changing. Astronomical causes, like we know that our Earth revolves around sun. So at some point, Earth is very close to sun. So definitely there is more heat reception. Sometime it is very far away. So there is less heat. So this position also helps in building the global warming. Geographical factors, like there are somewhere we find that forest is there, mountain is there, plain is there, plateau is there. These are also contributing factor for global warming. And lastly, we discussed this GHG in the previous slide. And the major contributor, which is seen along with 7th point, the 8th point is important, because land use is very, changing very rapidly due to the increased agricultural activity, due to the increased deforestation. So deforestation leads to release of carbon, because the plants are basically sink of carbon dioxide. So they store the carbon. When we cut the forest, we release the carbon. So the amount of carbon dioxide is increasing. So these are some of the causes which are responsible for climate change. There are many more, but for the compilation, I have taken only these 8. Now, as our topic says, impact of climate change, we have to focus on much more time on this. The climate change impact can be seen in many dimensions. For the sake of discussion, I have divided into 3 components. One is the environmental component. Second is the economic component. And third is your social component. So these are the 3 sectors which are affected mostly by the change in climate. So as we can see, the glacier ice caps are melting. This is the first thing which is seen. And as above in right hand side, they have given a photo that there is, as the time is passing, the amount of glaciers are shrinking. So whatever glaciers are melting, they are becoming water and increasing the sea level. So you can see, jab yahan par ice cap or glacier melt ho rahe hain, to inka pani jo hai samundar mein ja raha hai, and that is causing increase in sea level rise. And here you can see every sea level in the past 100 year has gone up around 8 inches, and it is causing the, you know, threat to the many small island countries like Tuvalu, Kiribati, Maldives. These countries are facing प्रॉब्लम इन कमिंग फ्यूचर. इसके अलावा जब हमारा सी लेवल इंक्रीज हो रहा है तो जितना भी कोस्टल हैबिटेट है वो कोस्टल हैबिटेट भी डूब रहा है. हम जैसा कि जानते हैं कि जो कोस्टल एरिया है पूरे वर्ल्ड में जो पॉपुलेशन का बहुत बड़ा हिस्सा कोस्टल एरिया में रहता है, तो जैसे जैसे सी लेवल राइज होगा कोस्टल एरिया जो है वो सबमर्ज होंगे और जो प्रोडक्टिव लैंड है वो धीरे धीरे कम होती जाएंगी. तो इस वजह से वहाँ पर जो कम्युनिटीज़ डिपेंडेंट हैं या जो भी इकोनॉमिक एक्टिविटी डिपेंडेंट है उन सब में प्रॉब्लम होगी और होनी शुरू हो गई है. नेक्स्ट प्रॉब्लम जो हम देख रहे हैं वो है इकोसिस्टम चेंज. इकोसिस्टम चेंज में सम ऑफ आई लिस्टेड, देयर इज अ चेंज इन क्रॉप पैटर्न. क्रॉप पैटर्न में हम एक एग्जांपल ले सकते हैं, जैसे अगर आप इक्वेटर में हैं तो इक्वेटर का टेम्परेचर जो एक एवरेज टेम्परेचर होता था वो एवरेज टेम्परेचर अब बढ़ रहा है. जैसे जैसे वो टेम्परेचर बढ़ रहा है हम इक्वेटर से ऊपर नॉर्दर्न और साउथ नीचे साउदर्न में जाते हैं वो टेम्परेचर धीरे धीरे कम होता जा रहा है. तो जो क्रॉप पहले इक्वेटर में होती थी वो क्रॉप अब धीरे धीरे ऊपर भी होनी शुरू हो गई. इसकी वजह से कई सारी समस्याएं भी हो रही हैं. जो डिजीज सिर्फ इक्वेटर में थी वो टेम्परेचर बढ़ने की वजह से टेम्परेट रीजन में भी फैलनी शुरू हो गई. तो क्रॉप पैटर्न के लिए कुछ लाभदायक भी हुआ है तो क्रॉप पैटर्न की वजह से कुछ समस्याएं भी हुई हैं, क्योंकि अधिक टेम्परेचर हो जाने की वजह से जो कार्बन फिक्सेशन की जो प्रोसेस होती है उससे क्रॉप की प्रोडक्टिविटी भी प्रभावित हुई है. दूसरा, फॉरेस्ट टाइप भी शिफ्ट हो रहे हैं. जो इक्वेटर पर फॉरेस्ट था वो धीरे धीरे टेम्परेट की तरफ जा रहा है. टेम्परेचर बढ़ने की वजह से बायोडाइवर्सिटी लॉस भी हो रहा है. जो स्पीसीज उन टेम्परेचर पर सस्टेन नहीं कर पा रही है उनका एक्सटिंक्शन भी हो रहा है. राइज इन आईएस, आईएस मींस इन्वेजिव एलियन स्पीसीज. देर आर मेनी स्पीसीज विच आर नॉट प्रेजेंट इन अवर टेरिटोरियल रीजन, दे आर मूविंग फ्रॉम वन प्लेस टू अनदर प्लेस बिकॉज ऑफ द चेंज इन टेम्परेचर. सच एज हम एक एग्जाम्पल देख सकते हैं, सन 1960 के दौरान में हमारे यहाँ जब यूएसए से गेहूं आयात हुआ था तो उसके साथ एक इन्वेजिव स्पीसीज आ गई थी जिसको हम बोलते हैं कांग्रेस ग्रास. उस कांग्रेस ग्रास ने भारत में जो इकोसिस्टम है उसको बहुत ज़्यादा प्रभावित किया है. अब जैसे जैसे गर्मी जो ये क्लाइमेट चेंज हो रहा है ये धीरे धीरे स्पीसीज मूव कर रही है अदर एरियाज में, इनकी वजह से जो इकोसिस्टम की जो प्रोडक्टिविटी है वो भी डिक्लाइन कर रही है. ओजोन डिप्लीशन भी हो रहा है, डिफॉरेस्टेशन भी नेचुरल हो रहा है बिकॉज जो क्लाइमेट चेंज होने की वजह से जो क्वालिटी ऑफ फॉरेस्ट था वो भी फर्क पड़ रहा है. धीरे धीरे उनके प्रोडक्टिविटी भी कम हो रही है. हैबिटेट लॉस भी हो रहा है बिकॉज व्हेन द एरिया गेटिंग सबमर्ज द हैबिटेट ऑफ द एनिमल्स आर गेटिंग अफेक्टेड. अपार्ट फ्रॉम दिस देर इज एक्सट्रीम वेदर, इराटिक एंड अनप्रिडिक्टेबल रेनफॉल इज ऑल्सो इंक्रीज. इसमें क्या हुआ है कि इंटेंसिटी बहुत इंक्रीज हुई है, इंटेंसिटी भी इंक्रीज हुई और फ्रीक्वेंसी भी इंक्रीज हुई. जैसा कि हम पिछले 2-3 साल में अगर हम देखें तो भारत में आने वाले साइक्लोन की तादाद, साइक्लोन का नंबर बहुत बड़ा है. अभी कुछ दिन पहले हमने अम्फान साइक्लोन और कई और साइक्लोन आए, उनका नंबर भी बढ़ा है और उनकी इंटेंसिटी भी बढ़ी है. सो दीज कंडीशंस हैव लेड टू अफेक्टिंग दी पीपल लिविंग इन दी नियर टू कोस्टल एरिया एंड नियर बाई एरिया. अपार्ट फ्रॉम वेदर द इंटेंसिटी हैज ऑल्सो गॉन अप इन केस ऑफ ड्रॉट एंड फॉरेस्ट फायर हैज ऑल्सो इंक्रीज. द एग्जाम्पल वी कैन सी ऑस्ट्रेलिया, इट वॉज अ वेरी ह्यूज फॉरेस्ट फायर दैट हैज cause the loss of biodiversity, forest and some human also. So the forest fire frequency and intensity has also gone up, and heat waves, this is also causing great trouble to people who are living in temperate area as well as in the tropical area. On economy, we can see the impact is also visible, and developing countries, poor countries, suffer more because they are exposed to high temperature, they rely on agri-based economy, and they have less availability of insurances, risk support like health, air conditioning. So these are the factors which are more problematic, especially for the developing countries. And when these are the problems which are visible, we can see the growth rates are declining, and the growth rate declining leading to the unemployment, agricultural productions and productivity is declining, industrial production, and consequently the trade is also declining. The major thing which is also related with the economy, increased burden of climate-based disease like diarrhea, malaria, cholera, other vector-borne, waterborne disease has also increased, because someone is if ill, he need to be cured. He approaches the hospital. In poor countries and developing countries, the hospital are very less or not equipped with supplying the services. So consequently, it affects the productivity of human being, and it leads to decline in their efficiency. On society, we can see the effect is cumulative of the economic as well as environmental, and it leads to violation of human rights. The rights are many, so we will not go into that much of depth, but there are many human rights are violated, forced migration are seen, mental health impacts are seen. These effects very much visible on the women and children. In case of women, we can see in the rural area, especially in India, we see the, you know, 80% of people living in rural area, the women has to collect water and fuel wood. So they go out, and this movement increases the risk of injury and rape, because they have to go far to fetch the fuel wood and sometimes water, especially in Rajasthan. So it is also having a potential effect, increased risk of waterborne and vector-based disease, and these are affecting pregnant women. More work in agricultural activity, because production is declining, so everyone has to work harder to get the more yield. So there is more engagement, and workload increases, especially to the women, because male member usually moves to urban area for cash employment. So the agricultural activity gets dependent on female. So this is also one of the impact which is faced by women. For children, we can see the climate change is affecting through disease, mortality, malnutrition, and educational deprivation. Because if we don't have enough cash or money, we will definitely have a problem to provide the educational services. Same effects can be seen to the indigenous people, and they are also, you know, having very much great impact, because they live closely with the environment. Most of the people, especially tribals, living in the natural environment, so they face the problem related with the health, food, water, shelter, and spiritual well-being. The problem becomes aggravated, especially in case of areas like delta, low-lying area, and mountain-based communities, because these are the area which are firstly going to face the impact of climate change. Similarly, the effect can be seen on workers. They face extreme heat, temperature, precipitation, pollution, fire, industry. So we can see in nutshell that all sections of the society are facing impact of this climate change. But poor as well as developing people are facing much more risk than the developed countries. Now, after the impact, we can see the topic was state obligation and environmental law. Now, state obligation, this word has two meanings, state and obligation. So in for defining the state, I am taking the definition of state from Constitution, Article 12, that lists these four things that defines the state: government and parliament of India, executive legislature of union, government and legislature of each state, local and other authorities, local and other authorities under the control of government of India. So these are the, you know, entities which comes under the purview of state in legal term. And when we consider the state, the actions of these bodies that can be challenged before court when they are not fulfilling their duty, we can approach court as the violation of our fundamental right, and we can get remedy. Now, state have been decided in several cases, like electricity board case. Here they have given the, you know, Supreme Court has held that the other authority, the definition is very wide enough to include authorities created by constitution or statute on whom powers are conferred by law. So they have basically explained what are the other authorities. In case of Ajay Hasia, they have laid down that there is no rigid set of principle to define the state. The last one, does the state include judiciary? Because it's also part of our system. In USA, it has been clearly accepted. In India, I think now it has been established that courts also come under the purview of state. So after state, we can see what is the definition of obligation. Obligation is synonym for duty. So when we have a right, we have a duty. So when there is a creation of a state, we have certain duty to perform. So a state also performs certain duty for their citizens and persons living in their territory. Now, from where these duties arise? These duties arise because we have some legal setup. So there are law, certain things that makes the state bound to perform certain duties. So if we see our country, we can see there is a constitution, there is a national law, and we are also bound by international laws because we enter into conventions, treaty, customary laws with other countries, and we are part of UN. So we also follow the international laws. In case of national laws, we have several environmental acts, rules, regulations. So we can see that the state obligation arises from these. And these are delivered to the people living in their territory. So as we discussed, the international obligation, national obligation, there are many, you know, treaties, conventions we have signed. Some I have listed, especially pointing out that which is related to the climate change and related aspects. So Universal Declaration of Human Rights, International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights, then Economic, Social and Cultural Rights, especially related with women, the Convention on Elimination of All Form of Discrimination Right Against Women. These are some of the, you know, conventions we have adopted, and these conventions have incorporated provisions that enforces the state to render the duty. Apart from these, certain conferences have been organized to deal the problem of climate change. The first one was, it was held in 1972, and it's a landmark conference that is known as Stockholm Conference. It laid down the 27 principles. After that, after this this conference, in 1992, landmark conference held that is known as Earth Summit. This also incorporated 27 principles in which we evolved the concept of sustainable development. Along with that, the Earth Summit resulted into these five conventions or, you know, materials: Rio Declaration on Environment and Development, Agenda 21, then Forestry Conservation, Biological Diversity, and Convention on Climate Change. This Convention on Climate Change is related with our topic. This UNFCCC is the outcome of the Earth Summit. It especially deals with the controlling the impact of climate change. And after that, there is a follow-up conferences has been organized in 2012. This UNFCCC is basically an international framework that deals with the regulating climate change and their impact. It aims for limiting global temperature increase and climate change effects. To operationalize the convention, there is protocol. So for UNFCCC, Kyoto Protocol came into existence. And this, I think, came into 2005. The Kyoto Protocol did two things. One, it listed the greenhouse gases. So as we discussed, there were six gases which were listed. These are the greenhouse gases, and we have to come back to the 1990 level. And apart from that, it made compulsory for binding as a binding reduction target for the developed countries. For developing countries, especially India, the voluntary mitigation actions came into existence. And this Kyoto Protocol also evolved carbon credit, carbon trading mechanism, along with a mechanism known as clean development mechanism. Following this Kyoto Protocol, after Kyoto Protocol, the Paris Agreement came into existence, because Kyoto Protocol ended, and after that, Paris Agreement was made in 2015, where developing countries assumed greater responsibility. The difference is Paris Agreement focuses on limiting the temperature, which is increasing in our atmosphere. And this agreement is basically market-based mechanism. They are incorporating the carbon credit funding and reducing the carbon amount which is present in atmosphere. So these are the, you know, components of Paris Agreement, which it works. Three things for, you know, climate change India has taken up. That is very important for climate change mitigation. One is India will reduce emission by 33% to 35% by 2030, and it will be over 2005 level. So first thing India is going to do is the reduction of emission. And second thing is the electricity power generation will be mostly taken from non-fossil fuel source, so that there is no carbon emission. And third thing they are going to do, they are going to do create a carbon sink. Carbon sink means they are going to add more forest cover so that carbon dioxide is taken up and it is, you know, taken off from the atmosphere. So these three ways by which India is going to contribute for climate change under the Paris Agreement. But the problem has arisen. America has backed out from this climate change Paris Agreement. So India has taken up certain missions to fulfill the Paris Agreement by solar mission, energy efficiency mission, habitat, sustainable habitat, Himalayan. So there are 8 missions have been started by the government of India under National Action Plan of Climate Change. By these means, India will try to contribute for mitigating the climate change. Now, those were the, you know, in summary, we can say the conferences, agreements, deals at the international level. At the national level, the duty of a state is basically from constitution. And duties are basically listed under directive principle of state policies. In this, we can see during Constitution Assembly debate, Dr. Bhimrao Ambedkar said, a government which rests on popular vote can hardly ignore DPSP while shaping its policies. So, meaning thereby, when you are making any policies for mitigating climate change, mitigating poverty, mitigating any kind of problem or providing solution, you have to incorporate directive principles while making all policies, acts. So these directive principles are listed in Article 37. That clearly says these are not enforceable, but they are fundamental in the governance of the country. And it shall be the duty of the state to apply these principles in making laws. So that means it has clearly laid down whenever you are going to make anything, you have to incorporate these principles in this or that way. And what are the laws that has been defined under section, under Article 13.3. So any ordinance, order, bylaws, rules, regulation, notification, custom, uses, which is having in the territory of India, the force of law will be considered as law. So if anything is made, you have to incorporate these DPSP. So for climate change, I think barring few articles of DPSP, most of the articles are useful for climate change. For example, if you take Article 38, it says to secure social order. So when there is a climate change, I think poverty, social unrest, environmental problem is going to happen. In that case, if there is a problem in social order, you have to take care of it. You have to minimize the inequalities. You have to promote the welfare of people. So similarly, you can see Article 39, Equal Justice, Free Legal Act. You have to provide justice also where there is an inequality, any kind of, rights are suppressed. So if we go by one, I think we can find all the articles which are listed in directive principles have use as a state obligation, especially in terms of climate change, right to work, education, public assistance, provision for just and humane condition of work and maternity relief. As we discussed that pregnant women have a problem during the, climate change, disease are there. So state has to extend the services for women. Similarly, living wages, the people working from the poor sections, they should not be exploited. Cooperative societies will definitely help in uniting people working for productive agricultural material, because as the climate change is causing the decline in the agricultural production, the cooperative societies can do better. Similarly, the child care, childhood care, education to child, educational and economic interest of SC, ST and weaker section of society, these are the communities which are going to face the climate change impacts. So as we can see, these all are very important. And among all the DPSP, One is explicitly focused on climate change. That is Article 48A. Here, it is the duty of state to protect and improve the environment and safeguard the forest and wildlife of the country. So this article is very much explicitly laying down duty of a state to protect from the impact of climate change. So whatever, you know, National Climate Action Plan or Eight Mission, Paris Agreement, Kyoto Protocol, whatever is there, these all are linked with that. Similarly, we have a protection of monument, as we have seen that Taj Mahal is getting affected by the ozone, by the acid rain. So if our monuments are getting affected, we need to protect them. Then we have Article 51. It says promotion of international peace and security. This security involves environmental security. So how will you promote the international peace and security when we enter into the collaboration with other state in the form of agreement, convention, treaty? We are promoting the international peace, and we exchange the technological knowledge, technological material from one state to other state to mitigate the climate change. So all these things at international level is mandated under Article 51 as a duty of state. Apart from duty of state, the individuals has their duty also under fundamental duty. We also need to protect, improve the natural environment for forest, lake, river, wildlife. So it is not only the state duty, our duty is also involved for climate change mitigation. There are many articles which I'm not going to deal, but for the sake of knowing, like forest, it is included in concurrent list under the 11th schedule, the social forestry, farm forestry, minor forest produce. These are also included in 11th schedule as a, you know, Panchayati Raj institution. By promoting social forestry, climate change can be mitigated, because if we grow more forest, these forests act as a sink and they absorb the carbon dioxide. We get the fuel also, we mitigate the climate change also. So these are the sections which can be taken up for maintaining the climatic conditions. Similarly, the 12th schedule also says like that. And these are, you know, the items which have been introduced later in the constitutions, in the Constitution of India. So in the first part, we discussed the international aspect. In the second part, we discussed the constitutional aspect, which is dedicated. What are the dedicated articles that deals with the duties of the state? And when the state has discharged its duty from the international level and the constitutional duty, it has laid down certain acts. Those acts are specially dealing with the environmental aspects. So there are certain acts which are dealing with the environmental problems. One is Environmental Protection Act. Second is your Water Act. Third is your Air Act. Fourth is your Biodiversity Act. And recently we have one act, National NGT, National Green Tribunal Act, that has established the NGT for delivering the justice related to specifically environment. So this Environmental Protection Act is basically an umbrella act that is not directly related with the mitigation of climate change, but it helps in mitigating by bit, because under this act, the central government has a power to take measure to protect and improve the environment by making rules. So by using this act, the government has made rules for maintaining the coastal regulatory zones, maintaining the, you know, noise pollution, environmental impact assessment, the plastic rules, biohazard material rules. So by using this act, central government has made several rules which are contributing in minimizing the impact which is happening on our environment. Because this is a very lengthy act, so I have just summarized the crux of the act. Here, section 3-6 is dedicated for that duty. And apart from that, this act incorporates two international principles which were laid down in the Earth Summit. One is precautionary principle and polluter pays principle. Precautionary principle, you have to, you know, remain vigilant and take precaution before happening something. And when you have made any pollution, you have to pay for that. You have to pay for cleanup and, you know, restitution of those acts. So it incorporates the two international principles for which India is party. Apart from that, as we discussed, like it helps in the making rules for hazardous waste, biomedical waste, coastal regulation, environmental impact assessment, and have accordingly punishment for that. The act also have one very important feature that is called a citizen suit provision. By this, any citizen can take legal recourse for protection and improvement of environment. So this is one of the great feature of Environmental Protection Act, by which we can also become an active module, active entity to prevent the environmental issues. Then the second one is the Air Pollution Prevention and Control Pollution Act. This act is also one of the, you know, very big act, but I will summarize in nutshell. This act is different from Environmental Protection Act because environmental protection is an umbrella. It involves all component of environment. It can make rules, regulation for all components, be it biosphere, atmosphere, or any sphere which is getting affected by human activity. But this act, Air Act, is only a specific legislation dealing with the air pollution. Under this act, they have mechanism to establish an institution, and that institution is called as Central Pollution Control Board and State Pollution Control Board. These boards can be established by using this act. And these boards helps in regulating the environmental problems. As it is mentioned here, it helps in prevention and control. It helps in monitoring. It provides mechanism for prevention. It ensures standards, how much emission you are going to do. And it also penalizes. So by use of this act, we control the pollution of air specifically with the help of institutional setup that is called as CPCB, and at state level, State Pollution Control Board. Similarly, the Water Act is dealing with specific component that is called as water. If there is a pollution related to water, problem in water, then we apply this act. And this act has also the power to establish the Central Pollution Control Board and State Pollution Control Board. And their powers are listed here. So by these boards, these institutional mechanism, Air and Water Act helps in controlling, regulating, preventing the pollution related to the water and air. In this, there is also provision of citizen suit as in the Air Act. So climate change can also be protected by another legislation, that is Wildlife Protection Act. This is not going to directly tackle with the climate change, but there are 2-3 provisions that can be directly linked with the climate change. One, the act has power to establish national park, wildlife sanctuaries, conservation reserve, community reserve. So these are the protected area which can be declared under this act. So suppose if I am going to declare, if a state going to declare a particular area as a national park, there will be legal sanctity for not to cut, not to kill any organism, plant. And if there is a flourishing forest, definitely it is going to absorb more CO2 and maintain the biodiversity and ultimately contributes to the climate change and global warming. So this act is also a part of environmental law that helps in establishing by these parks, sanctuaries, along with prohibiting the killing of plants and animals. With the help of this act, a special body has been created that is called as National Tiger Conservation Authority. This Tiger Conservation Authority, earlier it was working under the Project Tiger, that was based on project, but now it has a legal backup, and by this we save our flagship species, that is tiger, because tiger is one of the species that regulates the forest, and when there is a healthy forest, forest act as a sink for CO2. So we have to link the climate change with the each actions which has been given by state to maintain the environmental conditions. Similarly, there is a forest laws. As we can understand, the forest is, the very important component for ecosystem. They are basically providing oxygen, food, fiber, fuel, humidity, rainfall, and source of revenue. So they contribute by this services, along with they mitigate the problem of climate change also. So when these acts, the first act of Forest Act was made, there was no issue of climate change, but this act is basically not directly related with the climate change. It only lays down the classification of forest and how the forest is maintained and taxes are levied, how the produce are taken. So whenever any person, any community living near to the forest, they are regulated by these Forest Act. So climate change are affecting the indigenous community. Definitely these acts are going to help or provide the security as per their need. I'm not going to enter into the description. Similarly, the Forest Conservation Act, this is also an important act which is useful in term of climate change. Because in 1980, when it was felt that the forest amount is decreasing very rapidly, because in our forest policy, it has been said that there is need of 33% forest to maintain the ecology, to ecosystem. But it was found that the forest has declined very rapidly. So in 1980, central government enacted an act that is called as Forest Conservation Act. It led to the restricting de-reservation of the forest. So when you are not allowing the forest to go for cutting, definitely you are going to help in sinking of more carbon dioxide. So indirectly, it helps in the climate change. So if these forest acts are applied stringently and they are not allowing diversion of the forest for non-forest purpose, definitely they are going to contribute for climate change and global warming. The Biological Diversity Act is also an environmental law. The only one portion of this act is important, that is the conservation of biological diversity. Rest are related with some intellectual property related aspect and economic aspect. So this conservation is very important, which has been mandated by this act. And this act is outcome of Convention on Biological Diversity, which was held in 1992 in the Earth Summit. So to fulfill the commitment, India has legislated the Biological Diversity Act. And under this act, we conserve the biodiversity. There are various mechanisms. These work under the three-tier mechanism: national board, state board, and biodiversity management committee at the local level. So what is important to understand with the relation to the climate change, the conservation has been mandated, and by which we adopt several procedure and not allow the, you know, exploitation of biological resource so that they are maintained in our ecology and provide all services. One thing is very important under this act is it allows the establishment of biodiversity heritage site. So under this heritage site, we demarcate an area which is protected. That may be plant, that may be animal. So that helps in the contribution. And finally, the recent one is the, which is, we can say this act has given a tribunal, a special environmental court, that is National Green Tribunal. It was established under the NGT Act 2010. And now all environmental related aspects are dealt with this tribunal to ensure the healthy environment, minimize pressure on natural resource, to provide environmental justice, and speedy and expeditious disposal of cases related to the environmental aspects. This is very much active in current scenario and helping in protection of our ecology. This act basically does three things that is to be understood. It provides relief and compensation for damage to the person, and restitution of property or environment. So by this court, it provides three things: anything related to the environmental damage. Now, this tribunal adjudicate the matter by applying the principle of absolute liability, no fault liability, along with sustainable development, polluter pays, and precautionary principle. These are the principles which were incorporated in international laws like Earth Summit. So we are basically affirming our commitment, which was made at international level, by making the legislation at national level. So these are the basically state obligations which are taken from international level and translated at national level. So this act basically act as a this tribunal act as a civil court and applies the CPC. But apart from CPC, this tribunal also adjudicate the matter by applying principle of natural justice, which is not in the, you know, civil courts. But this court is not bound by Evidence Act, and the appeal from this court can be directly made to the Supreme Court. So now in present scenario, the NGT is working for the environmental related issues and helping for the mitigating the climatic change through solving the problem related with the environment. In this NGT, for knowledge, it has many member composition that can be divided into three parts. There is one chairman, Then there are members. Members are two type: judicial members and expert members. So numbers are variable, but these are the three type of people who judge the cases. In present time, the chairman is Justice A.K. Goyal, who is a former CJI. Now, by this, the offenses are basically non-cognizable. Penalties are imposed as fine or imprisonment in violation of the order of NGT. So we can see at the level of environmental law, there are many other laws also existing. But to tackle, we have one specific environmental court and certain umbrella, one legislation, which is umbrella legislation, that is Environmental Protection Act. And there are specific acts like Biodiversity Act, like Air Act, like Water Act. And there are many rules which helps in the mitigating the problems related to the environment and contribute the mitigation of climate change. These are some judgments which we am skipping. Now, at the end, we can see this climate change is basically not a local thing. It is a global challenge and it requires a global solution. It cannot be done at single state or individual level, but at global solution with the help of individual contribution. It can be done by application of 3R, 3R, reduce, reuse, recycle, use of technologies, behavioral change, like not to pollute, and respecting the nature. The solutions are very huge, but we can, you know, summarize, if we adopt these things, we can contribute in minimizing the climate impact very much. So with this, I will end my talk. I think I have taken 15 minutes extra.
Thank you so much, Dr. Saab. It was a great talk. And perhaps, you know, this was one of the unique lectures delivered on our Ambedkar School platform. You have succinctly explained the environment and the state's obligation, laws dealing with the environment and the climate change and how that is impacting the whole world and also the Indian population and particularly the marginalized sections of people. We truly appreciate the efforts and the efforts you have put forward for explaining this topic. We think this was a unique lecture, and our audience would definitely take it in that perspective. I now call upon our friends to ask the questions. There are so many questions today, particularly from the YouTube. We have 5-6 questions, and then we also have some questions. So I would request Rishi Raj to go ahead and ask his questions first. Yeah, Rishi Raj, unmute.
Yes. Am I audible?
Yes, yes.
Thank you so much, Dr. Maurya, for such an enlightening lecture. It was quite elaborate and extensive, and I'm sure I learned a lot, many things. My question is that we have many judgments by the Honorable High Court and the Supreme Court upholding that right to clean environment is included in right to life. We have the Subhash Kumar versus Bihar judgment. We have the Milkman Colony Vikas Samiti versus Rajasthan judgment, etc. My question is that, in your opinion, to what extent have these various environment protection acts helped realize that guarantee that right to life does in fact include right to a clean and healthy environment?
Actually, the answer for this is very difficult, because when we want to ensure those judgment at the people level, these judgment has to be translated by the authorities who are implementing these acts. For example, suppose you want a clean air. For clean air, we have to follow the Bharat Stage 4. We have to follow the certain norms. And we are in such a condition that the lacuna arise at the level of execution. Judgments are fine, laws are very fine, but implementation becomes problematic. So until we are not implementing by ourselves, suppose we have a vehicle, we have to keep it at that level, it is polluting very less, or whatever our effects, our acts causing the problem, we have to one minimize it. And at the level of implementation, suppose someone is not, I have seen in Delhi or somewhere else, their vehicle is polluting too much, but nobody is taking action. So if those are not regulated at individual level as a duty, as well as enforced by the people, I think those judgments and the acts will remain on page.
I have a small follow-up question, if I may be permitted to ask. So you just mentioned about individual people using such tools and such vehicles, which produce a lot of pollution. So my follow-up question is that, in such a scenario, what according to you is the biggest challenge that we are facing in shifting to clean energy resources or alternative energy resources? Are these institutional challenges? Are these community-based challenges that certain groups are not willing to transform, or we are facing some institutional challenges like we don't have a proper law or we don't have a adequate legal framework for that? So what according to you is the biggest challenge for transitioning towards clean energy, alternate energy?
Sir, isme challenge ye hai ki jaise main apne college ka example leta hu, agar mujhe apne college mein solar panel lagwane hain, to wo solar panel theek hai, matlab clean energy ke source ho sakte hain, magar unki abhi to ek investment cost hai, wo investment cost lagane wale ke paas itni available nahi hai. वो एक छोटा सा सोलर पैनल तो लगा सकता है, मगर एक बड़ा सोलर पैनल नहीं लगा सकता. तो एक तो उसकी कॉस्ट है, दूसरा अगर हमें उस चीज़ को और बढ़ावा देना है तो हमें संस्थागत रूप से कहीं से लोन और उसकी जो टेक्नोलॉजी है वो चीज़ें हमें अवेलेबल कराई जाएं, हमसे जो उत्पादन हो, जो बिजली का उत्पादन हो, जो भी एनर्जी का उत्पादन हो, एक्सेस वाला हमसे ले लिया जाए. सो देयर इज़ अ लिंक, देयर इज़ अ नीड टू क्रिएट अ लिंक of as a grid, receive the excess energy and provide the financial support so that we can install those things, which I have seen is a missing problem. Somewhere it has been done, like I have seen in Metro, in Delhi Metro, they have well planned it, but they are big entity, they can do it. But for us, we need support. And that support should be, you know, easy going, not a very complicated procedure to apply for that. Then you run for longer time to get that money to install that. I think for that, we have to make it easy so that people can take it easily. There is some erratic problems, like there is some problem like 24-hour supply of the electricity is not through this. But in daytime, we can generate and give it to grid. And then in night time, we can take from the other sources as a, return. So we have that thing. There is no community challenge. It can be made easy for getting those things so that it will be definitely useful and we can get the, you know, result as commitment made in the Paris Agreement, 40% through the, removing from fossil fuel sources.
Thank you, Dr. Maria.
Dr. Saab, I have one question. कि आप जैसे कि जानते हैं कि देश में कई सारी policies बनती हैं, and वो policies जैसे industrial policies हैं, और बहुत सारे मतलब जैसे you know that there is a Make in India policy, now river cleaning policy. then we have regulation of festival policies. तो जैसे ये मेक इन इंडिया पॉलिसी बनी है तो डू यू थिंक कि जब गवर्नमेंट ऑफ इंडिया पॉलिसी बनाएगा तो दे शुड मेक दी एफर्ट्स यू नो टू इवैल्यूएट एंड एक्सेस द एनवायरमेंटल इंपैक्ट ऑफ द पॉलिसी इंप्लीमेंटेशन दैट दे आर डूइंग एक्चुअली बट देन दे आर नॉट मेकिंग दैट एफर्ट्स पब्लिक मतलब लोगों को बता नहीं रहे हैं कि जैसे एक कंपनी जैसे एक हम लोग एक मल्टीनेशनल कंपनी को इंडिया में लाते हैं टेक एन एग्जाम्पल की फॉक्सवैगन कंपनी आई है Volkswagen जब अपना एक प्लांट सेटअप करेगी तो उसका इन्वायरमेंटल इम्पैक्ट लोगों के ऊपर होगा उसके एरिया में कितने लोगों के ऊपर होगा और कैसे होगा और उसको कैसे मिटिगेट किया जाएगा तो इसको लेकर क्या फिलहाल में क्या पॉलिसी है गवर्नमेंट की और कैसे इम्पैक्ट होता है और लोगों को क्या राइट्स दिए जाते हैं इसके बारे में आप बताएंगे बहुत बेहतर
सर इसके लिए क्वेश्चन तो आपका बहुत अच्छा है इसके लिए पूरा एक लेक्चर लगाना पड़ेगा जो मैंने जैसे बोला था कि जो इन्वायरमेंटल प्रोटेक्शन एक्ट है उस एक्ट के अंतर्गत सेक्शन 3-5 में सेंट्रल गवर्नमेंट को पावर होता है रूल बनाने का और उसी रूल पावर के तहत सरकार ने इन्वायरमेंटल इम्पैक्ट असेसमेंट रूल्स बनाए हैं उस रूल के तहत जो भी कोई नई कंपनी लगती है जो तो उनको क्या करना होता है उनको सर्वे और असेसमेंट करना होता है और उस असेसमेंट को लोगों के साथ शेयर करना होता है जितने भी स्टेक होल्डर होते हैं और उनसे उनके ओपिनियन लेने होते हैं उसके बाद लोग अपने कमेंट देते हैं पब्लिक इन्वॉल्वमेंट होती है पब्लिक हेयरिंग होती है जिसमें डिस्ट्रिक्ट कलेक्टर सेंट्रल पोल्यूशन बोर्ड स्टेट पोल्यूशन बोर्ड सारे इन्वॉल्व होते हैं और उनके बाद एक एनवायरमेंटल इम्पैक्ट असेसमेंट रिपोर्ट जमा की जाती है जब वो रिपोर्ट जमा हो जाती है उसके बाद मिनिस्ट्री जो है आपको परमिशन देती है कि आप इस एक्टिविटी को शुरू कर सकते हो बट जैसा कि मैंने कहा और अभी आपने कुछ दिन पहले एक केस सुना होगा आंध्र प्रदेश में एक गैस लीक कांड हुआ था एलजी का था तो उस एलजी में जो बाद में मैंने जो पढ़ा एसोसिएटेड प्रेस के एक पब्लिकेशन में मैंने न्यूज़ में पढ़ा कि वो जो कंपनी थी उसने जो है अपनी परमिशन ही नहीं ले रखी थी जो कैपेसिटी इन्हांसमेंट किया उस कैपेसिटी इन्हांसमेंट का परमिशन उसके पास नहीं था तो ऐसे ही बहुत सारे लूप होल होते हैं जो कंपनियों के द्वारा कर दिए जाते हैं मैंने अभी सर के ऋषिराज सर के प्रश्न में कहा था कि जो एग्जीक्यूटिव होता है और जो जहां से ये ट्रांसलेट होता है अगर हम अपना प्रोसीजर वहां से टाइट रखेंगे तो मुझे लगता है कि हमें कोई हार्म नहीं होगा देखिए कोई भी एक्टिविटी करेंगे तो पोल्यूशन तो होगा ही होगा ऐसा तो नहीं होगा कि पोल्यूशन नहीं होगा लेकिन पोल्यूशन उतना होना ठीक है जितना प्रकृति उसको एब्जॉर्ब कर सके अगर उतना प्रोडक्शन हुआ और हमने एब्जॉर्ब कर लिया तो हमारा लेवल ऑलमोस्ट वी कैन लिव इन अ सस्टेनेबल हार्मोनियस वे बट अगर पोल्यूशन ज्यादा होता जा रहा है और हम उसे नहीं कर पा रहे हैं देन देयर इज अ प्रॉब्लम एंड दैट इज सीन एज अ ग्लोबल वार्मिंग और ऑल लाइक दैट सो फॉर इम्पैक्ट असेसमेंट There is a clear legislation. Rules are present. Environmental impact assessment and modified rules are probably coming in 2021. Draft is pending there, and it will be soon released. I think there is some discussion debates are going on. So that regulates our country, especially whatever question you asked.
YouTube ke questions ki taraf jaate hain.
Sir.
सर इट वॉज अ वंडरफुल क्लास एक सवाल मेरा है आपसे कि जैसे हम लोग यहाँ दिल्ली एनसीआर में रहते हैं और जो हमारा बिल्डिंग इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चर है डे टू डे यहाँ पे लगातार बिल्डिंग्स बन रही हैं रिहायशी कॉलोनी बन रही हैं नए नए ऑफिस दफ्तर बन रहे हैं लेकिन मेरी कॉलोनी में कोई एक ऐसा पेड़ नहीं है जिसके नीचे जाके मैं छांव में बैठ जाऊँ कुछ भी नहीं है बल्कि इमारतें बहुत सारी हैं तो ये जो स्ट्रक्चरल बन रहे हैं हमारे यहाँ स्ट्रक्चर बन रहा है इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चर डेवलप हो रहा है इसमें कई तरह की प्लानिंग्स नहीं है जैसे सोलर एनर्जी को लेके कोई प्लानिंग नहीं है कोई कूलिंग सिस्टम को लेके प्लानिंग नहीं है हम अपने घर में बिना एसी चलाए एक घंटा भी नहीं रह सकते इतनी गर्मी वाले ये रूम है या घर है तो ये इस तरह की जो सिटी प्लानिंग है या फिर हाउसिंग रेजिडेंशियल जो कॉम्प्लेक्स की प्लानिंग है इस पे क्या हमें और संजीदगी से काम करना चाहिए सरकार को और इस पे ध्यान देने की जरूरत है
इसके लिए तो सर मैं यही कहना चाहूंगा कि पर्यावरण सरकार का मुद्दा कम, हमारा मुद्दा ज्यादा है, बिकॉज वी आर गोइंग टू अल्टीमेटली अफेक्टेड. सो इफ समबडी इज कंस्ट्रक्टिंग अ बिल्डिंग, देयर आर लॉट ऑफ नॉर्म्स आर देयर, प्रोजेक्ट्स आर देयर, मेथड्स आर देयर. फॉर एग्जाम्पल, इफ यू सी इन जापान, जापान इज फेस्ड विद अर्थक्वेक एवरी डे, बट यू हैव नेवर हर्ड death. Why? Because everybody is honest, following the rules laid down by the government for constructing their houses, and they are following it religiously. तो उसी तरह आपने जो बताया कि अगर कोई बना रहा है building, तो वो ये सब चीजें इसको incorporate करे, और हमें as a citizen we should also push, support. अगर वो हमसे कहे कि भाई ठीक है, बिल्डिंग का कॉस्ट जो है 31 की जहाँ 32 लाख लगेगा, लेकिन हम आपको ये सब चीज़ें देंगे, तो आई थिंक वी शुड बी फेयर एनफ टू एक्सेप्ट दोज थिंग्स, सो दैट वी गेट दोज थिंग्स. हम ये कहते रहे कि सरकार ने शायद ये नहीं किया, वो नहीं किया, तो सरकार कौन है? सरकार हम ही हैं अल्टीमेटली. हमारे जैसा ही कोई ऑफिसर भी है वहाँ पर बैठा हुआ है, वो ऑफिसर भी ये मान के अगर चलेगा कि मुझे इस रूल को सही से कराना है, और हमें बैकअप है सिटीजन का, कि सिटीजन भी यही चाहती है कि एनवायरमेंटल फ्रेंडली हो जाए, तो शायद कोई रोक नहीं पाएगा, कोई भी कंपनी गड़बड़ नहीं कर पाएगी, कोई कुछ भी गड़बड़ नहीं कर पाएगा. एंड फॉर अस वी शुड ऑल्सो प्लांट वन ट्री, इंस्टेड ऑफ गिविंग गिफ्ट टू अ पर्सन टू देयर बर्थडे, वी कैन गिव गिफ्ट एज अ प्लांट, बी इट इंडोर प्लांट, बी इट आउटडोर प्लांट, वट एवर. I have taken this initiative in my college. Whenever there is a program, though the Prime Minister has already said that bouquet should not be given, I have started giving the, you know, potted plant, especially little bit grown up potted plant, so that it absorbs more carbon dioxide. So for environment, relying on government and official, better start environmental movement from the citizen. It is going to impact more.
Right, sir. One more question from YouTube. Developed countries are like America are having much more carbon footprint than developing countries like India, but they want us to produce less carbon. But developing people also deserve better lifestyle and development. How do you see the debate?
It's an old debate. Those who are powerful definitely will negotiate. They will definitely skip. As I told in the Paris Agreement, USA has taken exit. So I think if you have no might to pressurize them, they are not going to contribute for the voluntary cut of CO2, because their consumption and their lifestyle is too much high. They are energy intensive. So definitely they are consuming a lot. They will not reduce their consumption, because that will affect their quality of life. But definitely at the international level, we have to negotiate either as a group or becoming a powerful country. So whenever there is a negotiation table, these developing countries has to negotiate. They are not going to cut their energy consumption. But definitely they have certain technology, green technology, they are adopting it, they are using it, like they use cycle for moving a shorter place. But in India, if I go to college by cycle, I think people will ridicule me. This professor is coming by cycle. So why to have a stigma for that? We must use cycle. Whatever you can do, do it. It is good for your health. In Corona, I think most of the people have supported go by cycle. So for if you are living in 1 kilometer, 2 kilometer, 3 kilometer area, you can use cycle. So by using these things, I think we can contribute a lot. That debate will go continue. I think power will neutralize power.
Doctor Sahib, एक audience से सवाल है. सवाल ये है, राकेश नोगी आप पूछ रहे हैं. Sir, how is the effect of greenhouse on food product, greenhouse gases on food production, C4 plants कह रहे हैं, क्या देश में लगातार फूड प्रोडक्शन बढ़ रहा है, क्या इसके पीछे ग्रीन हाउस गैसेस का कोई हाथ है?
तो जिन्होंने पूछा है वो डेफिनेटली साइंस के हैं. थैंक यू फॉर आस्किंग द क्वेश्चन. जब टेम्परेचर बढ़ता है तो जो प्लांट होते हैं, प्लांट स्पेशली हमारी क्रॉप प्लांट है, वो दो कैटेगरी में बांटी गई हैं. एक वो प्लांट होता है जो C3 साइकिल से कार्बन डाइऑक्साइड फिक्स करता है, और एक वो प्लांट होता है जो C4 साइकिल से मतलब कार्बन को फिक्स करता है और प्रोडक्ट बनाता है. C4 का एग्जाम्पल है जैसे गन्ना, जितने भी ग्रासेस होती हैं वो C4 में आती हैं. तो जो C3 जो होता है उसमें एक एंजाइम होता है, वो एंजाइम हाई टेम्परेचर पर इनएक्टिव होने लगता है. लेकिन C4 में क्या होता है, एक एडिशनल एंजाइम के थ्रू कार्बन फिक्सेशन होता है. तो एट सर्टेन लेवल C4 प्लांट्स आर बेटर इन फिक्सिंग द कार्बन डाइऑक्साइड, C3 प्लांट्स आर लेस एफिशिएंट. एंड अब इससे जो है प्रोडक्शन बढ़ रहा है नहीं बढ़ रहा है, दैट आई कैन नॉट आंसर, बिकॉज एट कंट्री लेवल आई थिंक देयर इज नो डेटा दैट सेज हाउ मच प्रोडक्शन हैज इंक्रीज्ड बाय द इंक्रीज इन टेम्परेचर. आई थिंक आई डोंट हैव एनी रिपोर्ट लाइक दैट, बट सर्टेन डेफिनेटली फॉर C4 प्लांट्स विल हैव एज इन प्रोड्यूसिंग मोर देन द C3. एंड इफ यू आर गोइंग टू यूज दोज क्रॉप्स, योर प्रोडक्शन विल इंक्रीज. से फॉर एग्जाम्पल, as we discussed in Paris Agreement, we are going to use the, you know, non-fossil fuel. So if you are going to use the biodiesel is obtained from one source is your alcohol. So if you are obtaining alcohol, the source is sugarcane. You can produce more sugarcane, you can obtain more alcohol, you can use your alcohol for as a fossil fuel. So that can be, you know, useful for producing those crops which are C4 crops. So for them, I would say that I don't have any data for substantiating, but definitely till certain level, the C4 plant will perform good, C3 will perform less, but at the totality, because this global warming and climate change is influencing so many parameters. Parameters in sense, precipitation is increasing, rainfall is, you know, changing, humidity is changing, and all factors are changing. So you have to get the result by combining all the result in totality, not one factor, that is temperature.
Doc sir, from the perspective of law, there is one more question. There are certain laws which protect the environment and cast an obligation and duties upon the citizens. Now you have seen and you have also told us that, you know, it is a duty upon the people to protect the environment, and it is more duty upon the people and less duty upon the state. Maybe, you know, we can summarize it that way. But there is no changing the behavior of the people. Now, even when you see that there are certain laws and there is an emergency in the field of climate change, they would pollute the water, they would pollute the natural source of, you know, the water springs, and, you know, they would pollute the environment. Take an example that when it is told that, you know, when you are stopping on a red signal, you should off your car, but then they will not do that. So what do you think that, you know, whether the existing laws have failed or we need more stringent laws, and should we make the existing laws a cognizable offense?
I think if I say laws have failed, then I think it will be not a good statement from me, because we frame law as per our need. Whatever need has arisen, we have framed our laws. What is required, we shall keep amending our laws as and when the need is arising. Like as after reading this, I have seen citizen suit provision is there. Any citizen can approach, you know, court if there is any problem. But the citizen suit is having problem. You have to give 60 days prior notice. So suppose if any institution is polluting, if I get 60 days notice, I think in 60 days they will clean up everything. So there is need to change as per our requirement is there. So fail or that I am not that much of big level that I'll say it has failed, but definitely our constitution has given wide mandate to state. So we can use that mandate for framing whatever need arises, be it strict, be it simple, whatever.
And Sumit sir, can you hear me? Go ahead.
जी हम अभी वोट ऑफ थैंक्स करने वाले हैं या सवाल पूछना है?
नहीं, आपके पास सवाल बहुत है, बट डॉक्टर साहब के पास क्योंकि एक टाइम फ्रेम में वो लेक्चर।
एक्चुअली मैं तो इतना कहना चाहूंगा कि दिस टॉपिक वाज सो वाइड, आई गॉट यू नो स्टक वेयर टू स्टार्ट वेयर टू एंड. I tried to justify it by clubbing all the. That's why I could not include the judgment portion rendered by the Supreme Court or various courts. It would have been gone.
No, the class was excellent. It was so enlightening, and we got so much of information about many laws and the ecological system and on environmental impact also. But for rest of the thing, we would love to have you again for a new lecture. You can summarize these things in next lecture.
Definitely. Thank you.
So, thank you, Moria sir, for joining us and giving a very valuable time of yours and also enlightening our audience. Thank you very much. We would like to have you again on our platform. Thank you, everyone, for joining us. Have a good day.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. Good night, Jeremy.